research capacity, you must be able to define the problems. And from early age, you must focus on what you really want to do and follow it. Then you must set clear objectives, as well as being able to conduct scientific research that is and build sustainable institutions. The research you are going to conduct, I always say, must be relevant and must have application. And it is believed that you should take science to a level that you can transfer it into a financial gain. After all, if you are doing research and you are not getting any benefit, it's of no purpose. And then you must identify key solutions for national problems. In this focus, I'm talking about sexually transmitted disease, how we have been able to focus on this, because these are the untreatable infectious disease. Now, people here have talked a lot about all the various sexually transmitted disease in Africa, from Ebola to the various ones, and then the STDs. Now, with regards to sexually transmitted diseases, chlamydia, gonorrhea are probably the most valuable one that has caused damage on the reproductive capacity of women. So is syphilis. HIV is difficult because now we have to, they have to go through IVF in order to prevent transmission. Now, this is a list of all the various sexually transmitted diseases, but I'm not go through this for because of time. But here you have the chlamydia trichomatis, and Neisseria gonorrhea. And then you also have Trichomonas vaginalis among the protozoa, which have created problems. Now, when it comes to STD and infertility, the five potential sites are in the vagina, the cervix, the endometrium, the tubal and peritubal area, and the ovary. And these are the areas where you have the disorders taking place. And the infection can occur in any of these five areas. With chlamydia, it is a silent epidemic because you don't even know, as has been presented yesterday, in 70% of the cases in the female, they don't have any symptoms. And it has been linked to about 4 to 8 million new cases every year. It's the commonest cause of ectopic pregnancy and early miscarriages. This is what it may look like in the cervix. You can see the discharge there of the chlamydia, very purulent discharge when it shows. Now, most cases who have this, they present with infertility. And the infertility will require assisted reproductive technology. Like gonorrhea, for example, it causes irreversible tubal blockage. Even when you, in the days of tubal reconstruction, when you do it, it comes back because it has destroyed the microflora in the fallopian tube. And clinically, you can take the swabs from these areas, from the cervix, rectum, and these are the various places you can take the culture for testing. Now, what factors prevent access to healthcare in Africa? Sometimes it's the matter of accessibility. It's not geographically, the the center to treat is very far. Then you can have the needed services is not available. And then the financial accessibility, if it's not available. And lastly, sometimes religious acceptance. We have men who refuse to follow their women to an infertility practice, saying that they are not supposed to consult anybody before they can have children. They should be able to do it on their own. And also, people who don't have the fund, they don't have the means. Now, what capacity has been built in the past and in the present? In the past, as I said, institutions gave training leave for their doctors to go and study abroad. And when they do, they get relevant training. In my case, I was sent to the University of Omaha in Nebraska. I got my training. By the time I finished this training, after my medical degree, a PhD and fellowship, I was asked to stay in the US to continue to work. But the training I had was such that I must return. And of course, the environment in Nigeria then was so nice that it was convenient to go back. And the fellowship I had from Population Council said that I need research grant, because if I don't have a research grant to work when I go back, I may not be able to continue my research. And the issue was that they didn't have that kind of money for my research. And the fellow that I knew there said I can approach Rockefeller Foundation. When I went to Rockefeller Foundation said that I wanted to do research, because this was the time that 79, Louis Brown had just been born, and so IVF was coming into practice. So I said, I like to do research in IVF. And they said, no, in Africa, you are overpopulated. Why are you going to populate the country again? So I went back and I said, and I spoke to my friend in Population Council. I said, what am I going to do? He said, they have grant for male infertility. Why don't you write a grant for that? So I did. Luckily, the grant for male infertility included all the equipment I needed to do IVF. So while I was doing the male infertility work, I was also doing the IVF work. And honestly speaking, that was what led to the pioneering work I did in vitro fertilization, where, as I said yesterday, from 1978 to 79, 90% of Nigerians traveled to Europe or America for infertility treatment, especially when they require IVF. And today, because of the way I have helped in the capacity building, only 2% of Nigerians travel abroad to get treatment. The story was that IVF started in 1976, but the first success was in 78 by Steptoe and Edwards. And then it moved to Australia in 1982, Howard Jones, and 1984 in Lagos. By this time, in 1984, I was already appointed a professor at the age of 32. And my impression was to prove to people, because I was told that if they made me a professor at that early age, then I may not be able to do any work again, like most professors do. Once they get that professorship, they don't help other people. And My point when I was in the U.S. was that a professor is not known by what he professes, but by how many professors he has made. And so I wanted to train as many people. I wanted to reproduce myself, and that was what I did precisely. So that up to now, I'm still involved in capacity building and research empowerment. Now, so that led to the birth of the first test tube baby in West Africa, Baby Olushola at that time. Following that, by 1992, it was not easy to get that work done in Africa because none of the centers we approached was ready to get us to know what they were doing. So we had to go back to square one. Luckily, in the US, I think Professor Simpson will remember Luigi Mansroni. He invited me to Philadelphia, and somebody called Jones in London at the London Bridge Clinic. So that was how I got some of my clinical work to the research work. And by 1992 in Caracas, myself and my colleague, we met Bob Edwards, where we presented our work, and he was so happy to now know that we've succeeded in that skill. So as they say, success has many parents, but failure is an orphan. We did not stop at that level. We realized that in Nigeria, sickle cell is very prominent. And when the technique of PGD started, we also started to get into that art. And the lead author here, Chizara Okeke, not the Dr. Okeke here, it's another Okeke, is a female who worked with me, with others, to have the first successful PGD pregnancy in Nigeria in 2014. This was from a couple that are both sickle cell carrier. So we were able to take them through IVF and then separated the abnormal sickle embryos and implanted a normal AA embryo into them, and they were able to have a normal baby that is sickle cell free. So, now, what is the future for capacity building in Africa? There must be continuous training, and there must be industrial support, like what is being done here. Developing capacity of training centers in Africa, we need that. We need centers. Somebody said, called it yesterday, centers of excellence. So we can have regional ones for different part of, side of research. But some people must have the think tank to strategize this for the region, not us individually working and working at cross purpose. And we need to expand the scope of research that are applicable to us in Africa. We need to be able to produce some of these vaccines and some of these medications in Africa so that it will be affordable for our people to get these assets. And then there's need for support of network of research fellows. And I'm happy that Merck has already responded to that by having that blog, but we need to make it active so we know what we're doing in different places. And the government needs to help it. I will tell you that these IVF centers we had started in the university, but when we asked for government to support it, they were not ready to do that. They wanted to build a new center, and they were spending money for other things, and there was competition. That was how I had to start a private center funded by myself with bank support. And it's probably the largest IVF center in Nigeria today. And the loan was paid back in 2 years. So now I'm laughing. Now, future collaboration. With the help of the African Fertility Society that I'm the president, we need to have a huge network of research and exchange of scholars and training. There is value for external support so that we can have this level of training. And it's not just for all the various needs that we have in Africa. There must be targeted, focused research to make it applicable. They said that no nation can become great without research. So no region also can become great without research. And in such doing, I know that when you empower women, when they work and they're empowered, it's like you're having two people, because the women are so committed and their husbands are able to enable them to go to what they're doing. Whereas for the men, they are multitask and they have other views to do and many things to handle. I've emphasized the aspect of network for capacity building. And lastly, I must thank Mark for giving me the opportunity to present this, because in my view, what has helped me to train so many people, as they call me the godfather of IVF in Nigeria, is just because I've made so many other people. And if there's anything that's driving me, it's in the word of Beethoven, who said that I recognize no superiority in mankind other than goodness. So that has been the driving force. Thank you for listening.